The viewpoints expressed on Night Fright are not necessarily those of the host, the staff, the sponsors, or the affiliate stations. Tonight's program may contain graphic themes or images. Viewer discretion is advised.
You guys good to go?
Yes. Oh, yeah.
All right. Do you guys know musicians?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. So here we go. Musician joke. Two musicians walk by a bar. It's possible. Showtime. Welcome to the show. Five decades after November 22nd, 1963, President Kennedy's assassination, crucial questions remain. A Coup in CAMELOT, a brand new documentary, provides extensive evidence of botched Secret Service protocols, Zapruder film analysis with 6K digital scans, shocking medical evidence revelations, and expert Oswald analysis, all to uncover the dramatic tale of the JFK assassination and what we were told by the government then and what we know now. The researchers featured in the documentary are Dick Russell. He's an Oswald expert. He's author of The Man Who Knew Too Much. 2 weeks from tonight, he's going to be on the show, folks. Author Sherry Feaster. She's a forensics expert. You can find her show in the www.nightfrightshow.com archives. She's a CSI, folks. She has used 21st century crime scene techniques to find a frontal shot. Science is now behind this. A frontal shot, of course, folks, which means two shooters minimum, and by definition, a conspiracy. Barry Ernest, who's also an Oswald expert and an author. Author David Mantic, he's a radiologist and was on last week with Douglas Horn, who's an Assassination Records Review Board member, and that show is in the archives also, folks, www.nightfrightshow.com. Electric. Two other researchers who are our guests tonight, author Vince Palamara, and fans of this show will recognize that name and that face. What a face. He looks like he's 20. In reality, he's 110, folks. So whatever he's drinking, I recommend it to everybody. And of course, Vince is the Secret Service go-to guy anywhere on the planet. www.nightfrightshow.com. You'll find his archives there as well. Two shows, folks. And a brand new guest to the show, author Jerry Dealey, who's an historian. Yay! And the crowd goes crazy. Now, you're going to recognize when I spell this name, D-E-A-L-E-Y. That's right, folks. He is a member of the family from Dealey Plaza, who the plaza is actually named after. Welcome both to the show. I want to welcome Jerry. I'm going to start with you, Jerry.
Okay.
Jerry, where were you November 22nd, 1963? I know where Vince was. He wasn't even a gleam in his father's eye at that point.
I was in third grade up in Denver. I spent school up in Denver. I moved there in the summer of 63. So I was in third grade at lunch when it happened up in Denver.
And what were the kids talking about? How did that come about? Did the teacher tell you, the principal? Were you sent home?
Well, yeah, we were at lunch, so we didn't really know what was going on. We came back from lunch, and they just sent us home without telling us why. Of course, everyone figured it out once we got home, but we did not know when we left the school.
Was it all over the television set when you got home? I'm just trying to bring the younger folks back to that.
All that weekend. I mean, if you think about it, that was nonstop news I tell people, I give tours and stuff, and I tell younger people, the biggest legacy of the Kennedy assassination is actually television news. Because that weekend, they covered continually all 3 days, and then, of course, the funeral on Monday. And after that, national television news became a major thing. And so the whole turbulent 60s is pretty much because the news covered so heavily on the assassination that weekend.
And how did the news coverage differ from 1963 to 9/11? Was there a big difference, in your opinion, Jerry?
Well, I mean, up until November 22nd, 1963, the national news, there was only one show that was a 20 minutes, I believe, and that was on CBS, Walter Cronkite. And the rest of it was like a 10-minute gig on the national news or on your local news. And then after that weekend, they had to cover so much, they started all doing at least a half-hour nightly news every night. And they started looking for stories, and that's how that all kind of built up. Versus 9/11, where we had continuous cable networks and continuous news all the time.
Was there big print as well? Was print more of a factor than it was on 9/11?
Yeah, yes, definitely. Back in 63, I mean, a lot of the newspapers basically would read, the television news would actually read the newspaper to get their stories. So the newspapers were the main source of stories back at the time. Local news a little bit with weather and sports, but pretty much everything was off the newspaper most of the time for national news.
So you're in grade three. I'm suspecting you're around 10 years old, 8 years old?
Eight.
Okay. So when you get home and on the Sunday morning, Jack Ruby sets up and shoots unceremoniously Lee Harvey Oswald live on television, were you in the room at that time?
I believe so. It's hard to do memories in there because once the shooting happened on one network live, they repeated it so many times that day. A lot of people have memories of being seeing it live that didn't actually see it at live. They just saw one of the rebroadcasts of it.
What were your parents saying at that point? Were they confused? Did they think perhaps there could be a conspiracy here after all? Because you've just had somebody who's been accused of killing the President of the United States shot right live on television by a known mafioso.
Right. A lot of the initial theories and beliefs were that it was a conspiracy because it was a pro-communist, allegedly, you know, pro-Castro, allegedly. You know, the initial reactions, most of the people on the shooting was, you know, it was Dallas, so it was right-wing, the extremists in Dallas, extreme right-wing, the oil men, and the people who hated Kennedy. But then as police were almost relieved when they arrested a communist because it left suspicion off the right wing and more towards communists and everything else. But then once he shot, of course, most of the people did not know Jack Ruby was a known mafioso at that point.
Yeah, exactly right. And I know from my own parents, that was the big turning point. They thought, wow, what the heck is going on? You know, all of a sudden we're dealing with the loss of the President of the United States, and the assassination takes place of Lee Harvey Oswald only 3 days later, and we all know the first rule of assassination, silence the assassin. And this is
cool.
what I think set off alarm bells right across the country. And then we have the Warren Commission obviously set up to cover it all up, etc. Now, you had mentioned that you do give tours. Are your tours in Dealey Plaza, Jerry?
Oh, yes. I live here in Dallas, so I'm constantly giving tours. We give private group tours instead of the public tours, like the buses. They're pretty much talking down to everyone. But a private group tour, we cover the plaza, everywhere Oswald went through that afternoon, the Tippit shooting site, the Texas Theater, the rooming house, et cetera, the Neely Street houses where the backyard photos were taken, all sorts of things. But it's a private party tour. So it's a tour anywhere from 3 up to 50.
Okay, can you walk us through the first part of that tour? Where do you start off, in Dealey Plaza, or do you start off outside?
Well, it depends on where I'm picking up my guests, but typically we'll go Dealey Plaza. I'll pretty much cover the interior of the building. My area of expertise is more the history of the plaza and Dallas itself. Also, my expertise, most of my research, you know, like Vince does Secret Service, I do the interior of the building. Most people do not realize what the interior looked like in 63. and how difficult it would be for strangers to access and get in and out of the building without being spotted by the 73 employees in that building.
Let's go there right away. Why would it be difficult? You know, we've heard the rumors before that there was construction going on the sixth floor Texas School Book Depository, folks, where Lee Harvey Oswald is alleged to have taken the shot. People think, you know, certainly in the movie JFK by Oliver Stone, masterpiece of a film, in my opinion, even if you don't like what it says, I think as a film, it's just absolutely brilliant. And the fact that it got all those records released on top of it, I think it could be one of the most powerful films of the 20th century, without question. So what is different in the building? Why was it so difficult then for somebody that, quote unquote, would be a foreigner to the building to get in and out without being spotted? Because this is essential.
Well, right. I mean, the employees of the building, there was about 75 to 76 employees in that building. There were 12 warehouse workers, a number of office workers for the different publishing companies, but they all kind of worked related to the Texas School Book Company. The public itself never went much past the will call counter on the first floor. If there were anyone else in any of the other locations of the building and they were unescorted, people would be curious who they were and what they were doing in there. The second, third, and fourth floor, the front of the fourth floor, were all office spaces for the various publishers. And then the back of the fourth floor, the fifth, sixth, and seventh were all warehouse spaces where they stored the books. Now, to access the building, you know, it's two front doors and then a dock door in the back. But then to access the upper floors is more of a problem. There was a passenger elevator that only went up to the fourth floor. Again, the building built in 1895, the Southern Rock Island Plow Company, only was a five-story building. It was gutted by fire in 1901, pretty much gutted the back of the building, so they rebuilt it and added the sixth and seventh floor to it. And at the time, they built a passenger elevator without putting a shed for the lift mechanism up on the roof, so it only went up to the fourth floor. And that was the only passenger elevator as far as it went. Now, to get up to the fifth, sixth, or seventh floor, you had two options. Either the pair of freight elevators, and these were two elevators in one shaft. They had slatted wood fronts to them. They had a mesh fence on the back of them so you could see into the elevator. So anyone traveling up and down would be exposed every floor they passed to anyone in the building. Now, the stairs that, you know, Barry Ernest also in the movie, with the girl on the stairs were single flight stairs. They went up one halfway, about 3 foot wide, wooden, old wooden stairs. They went up the other half, and then you had to cross 20 or 25 feet of the floor to get to the next stairs. They weren't stairs like a landing like you normally think of a stairwell. So anyone sneaking in and out of the building would have to access the fifth, sixth, or seventh floor using either the freight elevators, where they could be seen by every floor they passed, or the stairs, where they would cross 20 to 25 feet of open space to get up to the fifth, sixth, or seventh floor.
People don't realize that the elevator was stuck, I think, on the sixth floor, and nobody could access it either. Is that correct, Jerry?
I don't believe it's correct. At least Eugene Boone, one of the deputy sheriffs, he came to the building and he got on the freight elevator, and he took it up to the second floor and let a couple ladies off. And then he could not get to work after that point, but that was only the second floor. But it had a dual wooden slatted gate, and if you didn't close both gates, it would not move for safety. So he could have let them off and only closed one gate and not realize that deactivated the elevator.
Was there a basement, Jerry, that the elevator went all the way down to?
Yes, there was a basement that the freight elevator went all the way down to, and there was also a stairs in the first floor up towards the front that went down to the basement.
Okay, so there was no other elevator that they could take. I'm thinking of the Daltex building, you know, it had not a freight elevator, it had an ordinary elevator that would carry people upstairs. It never had that at all?
No, not per se, not a passenger elevator down the basement. It was only the freight elevators that would go down there.
Did the access to the basement, was there access to the outside? In other words, could you walk down a set of stairs and get into the basement?
There was a chute off the loading dock on the west side of the building. There was a chute that they would go down on rollers and go down there so they could unload boxes and push it down the chute and go into the basement if they needed to. But there was not actual outside people access. You could get up, I guess you could slide up and down the chute. It would be very difficult.
Yeah, I'm just trying to think, you know, how two shooters on the sixth floor, if it's not Oswald, do you think it would be possible for the two of them to get down those stairs and not be seen by anybody? Or is there any way out of that sixth floor school book depository floor without being seen whatsoever?
Well, I mean, someone could rappel down the outside of the building, but again, you're going to be seen by the crowd on the outside. There was also an outside fire escape, but that was on Houston Street, and the majority of the crowd was on Houston Street, so I don't think anyone would come down that way. You mentioned the repairing of the sixth floor, and in JFK, Oliver Stone has an outside work crew repairing the sixth floor. But the six gentlemen repairing the sixth floor, and they were not actually repairing, they were overlaying it with plywood, were all employees of the building. And Commission Exhibit 1381 by the FBI interviewed all 73 employees, and only one, Danny Arce, reported any stranger in the building whatsoever.
What was that report? That's the first I've heard of it.
About 5 minutes after 12, a little old man needed a restroom, so Danny Arce walked him in, showed him where the restroom was by the domino room in the back of the first floor, and Danny said he basically waited till the gentleman came out. The gentleman went out the front of the building and got in his car, left, walked away at any rate. And that was 20 minutes before the motorcade came through.
Do you think there was actually somebody on the sixth floor then given this for the assassination? You don't know.
Again, I'm a fence sitter as far as whether or not Oswald was a shooter. And even if he was the only shooter in the building, that still does not eliminate conspiracy by any means. But if he was the only shooter in the building, you know, that's possible as far as I know. But as far as planning the other building, we do know the movements of most of the people on the stairs, and I've given presentations at some of the conferences on those movements. And there is windows of opportunity to go up the building through the freight elevators from where Bonnie Ray Williams, about 12:05, went up to the sixth floor to have his lunch and had his lunch supposedly about two windows down from Oswald. There's about a 15-minute gap of time in there where we don't know of anyone using the elevators at all.
Yeah, I'm just trying to think how they could get in, but not only get in. I mean, once you've committed a crime like that, you're going to want to get out. I don't think you're going to want to try and find a place to hide and be stealthy or anything like that. Is there a possibility they could have ran up to the roof and just hung out there?
Well, Marion Baker, the officer that came in and was escorted for Roy Truly and had the lunchroom encounter with Oswald, he went up to the roof because he originally thought the shooter was on the roof because he saw birds flying off the roof at the first shot. So him and Roy Truly went up to the roof and spent about 10 minutes up there on the roof, making sure he checked, climbed up the Hertz sign and made sure there was no one up there, looked over the parapet, decided the 5-foot parapet would be too tall for someone to shoot over because they'd have to lay across the top of the parapet to get a shot down. But he spent about 10 minutes. There's a very small window of opportunity from the time Sandra Stiles and Vicki Adams came down the stairs, and also Bonnie Ray Williams, Hank Norman, and Junior Jarman came down the stairs about 12:35. There's about 3 or 4 minutes where someone was away, no one was by those stairs. And so someone could have stuck on the sixth floor long enough for after that 3 or 4 minutes to come down the stairs. And in fact, D.V. Harkness, one of the sergeants that was at Elm and Houston Street, he went to seal off the building, the back of the building at 12:38. And he said he encountered a couple individuals that showed him or told him they were Secret Service, so they let him go. And of course, we know there were no Secret Service on the ground in Dealey Plaza till about 1 o'clock.
Yeah, that's one of those factual things that the mainstream media likes to overlook completely. I'm not ignoring you, Vince. I'm going to get to you in just a few seconds.
No problem. This is fascinating. Very good.
It's great for me too, because this is a lot of information I was completely unaware of, and I really thank Jerry for coming on the show and telling the folks about this. Right across the street from the Texas School Book Depository was the Daltex building. Do you know much about that, Jerry, and Mr. Braden, and all the events that took place there?
I know a little bit about it. I mean, the word was that Jim Braden or Eugene Braden or whatever his alias and his real name was caught in the building. He was reported in the building as being a stranger in the building. He allegedly went in to use the phone. And so he was questioned by police briefly and released. That's all I really know about it.
Okay, and he had mafia connections as well, folks, just to let you know. He was on the third floor of the Daltex building, which is a building that many witnesses feel that the shots emanated from as well as the Texas School Book Depository. There are several spots around Dealey Plaza where people believe there were snipers positioned, and that is one of the buildings. So to have somebody like Eugene Braden arrested and questioned right after the assassination, his excuse for going into the Daltex building was to phone his mother to let her know that there was an assassination attempt on John F. Kennedy. But there's more of an alarming second part to that story. If we fast forward to June 6th, 1968, the hotel in which Bobby Kennedy was assassinated, and just a few blocks from there, guess who's picked up again in question? Jim Braden. Yeah. Coincidence? You decide. You decide. Yeah. There's a lot. Please go ahead, Jerry.
Daltex building would be a much easier building to sneak a weapon into. Again, it was a typical office building. It stands for Dallas Textile, not Dallas, Texas. But it was a typical office building where everyone leased part of a floor, an entire floor. So if you saw someone with a weapon there, a stranger, or someone walking with a rifle case or something like that, and as long as they weren't going to your space, you would assume they're going to one of the other spaces and that they belong there. It would be a much easier building to sneak weapons and shooters in and out of.
Yeah, I agree. And also in 1977, there was a spent shell found on the top of that, on the roof of that building. Now, the chances of somebody going down, folks, to a major urban center, just imagine this in your city if you're in a major urban center, and the exact place where the President of the United States had been killed only 22 years beforehand, or not even, I'm sorry, I've got my math wrong, and all of a sudden somebody finds a spent shell on one of the buildings that people felt that the shots emanated from, hello, and then you factor in Jim Braden on top of that from the same building. Yeah, when does coincidence stop and conspiracy begin? It's a very, very good question. In your tour, Jerry, do you talk about the Grassy Knoll?
Oh, of course.
Can you tell us some of the stories from that?
Well, I mean, I usually start with the building itself and the interior and how hard it would be getting out. And then I also cover the other buildings. And I will kind of disagree with you a little bit, Brent. I do believe it was the records building that had the shell casing found on the roof of it in 77, not the Daltex. But for whatever that's worth. But I also cover the other buildings. I cover police presence there in the plaza, why it wasn't sealed off as a crime scene, et cetera. And then, of course, we walk through. We talk about the missed shots. All the missed shots, are about seven of them, reported hitting the pavement to the House Select Committee on Assassinations. And then we'll do the Grassy Knoll and talk about the Zapruder perch and everything else. And that's pretty much the Dealey Plaza part of the tour.
Did you talk about James Tague at all and his wound? Because I think that's integral to the narrative. I mean, he's the reason why they had to invent the magic bullet. And I was just wondering if you could tell his story to the folks that are listening right now.
Sure. James Tague was coming up Commerce and pretty much stuck in traffic because the motorcade was coming through. So he got his car and he stood by the upright between Main Street and Commerce. And basically he was there during the shooting. And soon after the shooting, Buddy Walters, one of the deputy sheriffs, walked up to him and said, you're bleeding. And he had a fresh cut on his cheek. And he said, yeah, I did feel a sting. And incidentally, there was also I saw an impact on the curb in front of me. Now, this is the curb over between Main and Commerce, well away from Elm. And Dallas Morning News photographer, I just forget his name right off the top of my head, took a photo of a pin pointing at the mark on the curb right there. And the FBI report written 2 weeks after the assassination never mentions James Tague at all. They say, okay, one bullet went downward into Kennedy, one went downward into Connolly, one hit Kennedy in the head. Three shell casings, they're done. Well, James Tague and the news photographer, Tom Dillard, I believe, kept saying, well, what hit me? And so that was because of his injury and because of that mark on the curb, the Warren Commission had to come up with, okay, a bullet going down to either body could not come out of the car. A bullet in the head would not have enough momentum to clear the windshield, go an additional 250 feet, hit the curb, and bounce. And that's when they came up with, okay, maybe there was a missed shot. Now, they did have a few reports of shots missing and spraying towards the underpass. Skelton up on the overpass reported it. There was also a couple of Virginia Rachey over by the school book depository also reported an impact in the street behind the limo that kind of sprayed towards the overpass. And so they said, okay, misshot. That's when they had to come up with a single bullet theory to go through both men to cause all those wounds.
Yeah, it's a pretty wild narrative, folks. And www.nightfrightshow.com, you can find a book cover there called JFK Assassination, From the Oval Office to Dealey Plaza. And inside you'll have a first-person interview with James Tagan. God love him, he's gone now. But man, what a brave man he was. Vince, I want to go to you because we had touched on the Secret Service, the false Secret Service agents in Dealey Plaza. Can we talk about that? Because, again, this is one of the smoking guns, I call it. That means conspiracy beyond a question of doubt.
Oh, yeah, without a doubt. I think it's definitely one of the biggest smoking guns in the case. And I detail it in Chapter 7 of my book, Survivor's Guilt. Yeah, there you go. You got a copy, too. There you go. And there was quite a few witnesses reported running into a man who claimed to be a Secret Service agent. In fact, Patrolman Joe Marshall Smith encountered a fellow who had actual identification that satisfied him he was an agent. But later on, when he testified to the warrant, he says, you know what, then again, this guy had hands like an auto mechanic and something didn't ring true, but we were so pressed for time, which was also dramatized in the JFK movie itself. But the bottom line is, for years, people have wondered, well, was it a fake agent? Was it a CIA guy? Was it an assassin? I say possibly, but I present a third alternative a lot of people haven't thought of. Could it have been a real agent, and he was stationed there, like kind of like off the record, unauthorized, and when the assassination happened, they realized it's going to look really bad for someone to be there? Or, before you can catch your breath, was he there for sinister purposes? Now, keep in mind, there was the White House detail agents, and the Secret Service came out later on and said, well, no, all the agents in the motorcade were accounted for. 16 agents, that's the lead car, limo, follow-up car, vice president's car, vice president's follow-up car, and the White House press buses had Muggsy O'Leary, who was Kennedy's Senate driver, who was an agent in name only. But I said, well, wait a minute now. There's all the field offices. There's the Dallas field office. There's all these other field offices. There's other White House detail agents. It could be somebody else. And I actually tried, almost by process of elimination, to see if there was somebody who could be a candidate for that agent of unknown repute in the Plaza. And Abraham Bolden, who I interviewed, was very suspicious of a fellow agent by the name of Harvey Henderson. If you read his book, The Echo in Dealey Plaza, you can see why. But Abraham Bolden, in interviews with me, said that, you know what, there was one man who had the guts, the determination. I'm not saying Harvey was there, but I could see it happening. He said that, he definitely had suspicion toward Harvey being the agent in the Knoll. But whoever it was, and I just offer the possibility it could have been a real one, because it was, you know, it came out afterwards, and then that would have looked bad. When people, you know, look at this case, and they might be on the fence whether it was Oswald alone or Oswald with conspirators, or there was a conspiracy having nothing to do with Oswald per se. You know, he was a patsy, like he said. And you look at things, you try to look at something that's tangible and it's real. No one's ever come up with a valid counter argument for who that could be. I mean, it's one thing to say mistaken identity, but I mean, it was a couple of law enforcement officers that claimed they were Secret Service. The other one, I think, was D.V. Harkness, Seymour Weitzman. And again, like I said, Joe Marshall Smith saw credentials. I mean, it's not a matter of hyperbole. Oh, they meant, you know, I don't know, railroad detective or something like that. He said he was Secret Service and produced credentials in Joe Marshall Smith's case in particular. And when you factor in the fact that the Knoll was suspect number one for location of the frontal shot, when you add in the fact that people saw what looked like gunpowder or smoke, I should say, and smelled gunpowder, put that all together, and it makes you think that the agent on the Knoll, whether he was real, fake, unauthorized, definitely food for thought that he was, you know, something was going on there. Yep.
I should just give folks some context about Abraham Bolden. Abraham Bolden, folks, was the first African-American Secret Service agent handpicked by John F. Kennedy himself for White House detail. The man is an American hero. You must find out about this gentleman, because he is still trying to clear his name. He was a whistleblower after the assassination. And rightfully so, he was, because there were so many, as we're going to get into with Vince, there were so many screw-ups by the Secret Service, being drunk on duty, open windows, et cetera, that he went forward and he said, this was the type of people that, there he is, what a good-looking guy. Yeah, and he looks the same, too. Honestly,
he does. Yeah, he does.
He's an amazing guy. Just an American hero, folks. And he was set up for a crime he did not commit, to silence him by the Secret Service. Now, he also mentioned to me, Vince, when he was on the show, and www.nightfrightshow.com, you'll find three shows of Mr. Bolden in the archives. You got to hear this fellow. He's just so inspiring. He mentioned to me that there was a Secret Service badge that was lifted from the Chicago office where he was working, and he thought that perhaps that might be the badge that was shown behind the Grassy Knoll. What's your speculation on that?
I think that's definitely a possibility. There's no doubt about that. It could have been, again, a real agent that they covered up after the fact because it would look bad, or someone who had illicit intent. Or it could be, like what Abraham Bolden's going to do, could be that someone grabbed the real badge and, you know, used it for nefarious reasons. Definitely think that's definitely a possibility. Just the fact, again, can't, you know, it's not, it's one thing, you know, to, you know, a common citizen say, well, they could be mistaken. But this is Joe Marshall Smith, a patrolman who's seen fake IDs in his time, real IDs in his time. The guy said he was a Secret Service agent, produced credentials. So I definitely think Abraham Bolden's onto something. It's definitely more than food for thought, in my opinion. Yeah.
The JFK Assassination, the definitive book by Brent Holland. From inside the Oval Office to Dealey Plaza, first-person witness accounts. Order yours right now, nightfrightshow.com.
A coup in Camelot is what we're talking about tonight with two of the finest researchers on the planet that are also in the documentary. There it is. A coup in Camelot.
Coup in Camelot, excellent.
Yeah, and Vince sings the Camelot song in it. No, I'm kidding. Jerry actually does it. So
Jerry does it.
What
we both do it a cappella.
Yeah, there you go.
Okay, so what's important here, folks, is the fact that, you know, the Secret Service did things outside of the box, if you will. I was going to go back to Vince and ask him, Vince, did you ever discuss Abraham Bolden with any of the great agents that you, the great interviews you did with the agents?
Yes, I did.
What did they say?
I got a mixed response, but it was a curiously mixed response. Let me explain, and I'll keep it brief. Bob Lilly, not the Dallas Cowboy, but just coincidence, same name, very well-respected agent who was there for decades, not just at the White House, but in the Boston field office and several other offices, very highly acclaimed agent who guarded Kennedy from election night until October 63, and he was curiously transferred to the Boston office. When I started mentioning Abraham Bolden, he goes, oh, yeah, Abe was a very good street agent. And I'm like, oh, well, that's good to hear. And I'm thinking, but then all of a sudden he caught himself, says, well, but, you know, Abe got in trouble later on. And I'm like, well, wait a minute. His first impression, say this guy's a good street agent, had nothing wrong, nothing bad to say. Okay. And then when I spoke to Sam Kinney, the driver of the follow-up car in Dallas and many other stops, he said, oh, yeah, Abe. I remember Abe. Yeah, he had a short temporary assignment with the White House detail. He was the first, you called him black, first black agent of the White House detail. And I tried to help out old Abe when he started out with us. Then a little bit of a pause, and he must have realized, oh, wait, Abraham Bolden, oh, yeah. Oh, he's the first agent who ever got in any kind of trouble. You know, he's the first agent who ever got in trouble with us. And the other one was Gerald Bain, the special in charge of the White House detail. He defended Abe in a very backhanded way. He says, well, what he did wasn't that bad. He just got a little greedy. Now I want to explain for the listeners the bottom line here, and again, I'll keep this brief. Abraham Bolden received many accommodations for cracking counterfeiting in Chicago and across the nation. But in the early 60s, counterfeiting was rampant. People making fake $100 bills, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Higher denominations, lower denominations, fake savings bonds, you name it. And Abe was terrific. Again, Bob Lilly said he was a great street agent, and he was. And he came from a tremendous background. He was Pinkerton Detective Agency. I graduated magna cum laude from, Lincoln University. And again, he was handpicked by John F. Kennedy. And he did his time at the White House. And the reason why he didn't decide to stay on was you have to read his book, In the Interest of Time, Echo in Dealey Plaza. He didn't like the laxity and the drinking on duty and whatnot. But he went back to the Chicago office and served very well. And he ended up protecting Kennedy a couple of times when Kennedy came to town. In fact, in March of 63, Abraham Bowen was part of that detail. Now, to answer this $64 million question that some of your listeners say, okay, I know this is a little asterisk. You're talking about Abe. Abe got in trouble later on. Well, think about this. From 1865, when the Secret Service began, until now, Abraham was the first agent to get into trouble. Now, coincidentally, it's also in a time when, after the assassination, Abe loose lips sinks ships. He was telling people about the laxity of the Secret Service. I knew this was going to happen. I knew this was going to happen. Oh, Abe was so despondent and talking about how the Secret Service was lax, the drinking on duty, the parties, the carousing. And what they claimed was, and what he supposedly did was like a white-collar slap on the wrist, resort jail for a couple months thing, and he didn't do it. But he said that he tried to solicit a bribe involving a guy he was trying to send up the river, translation to jail, in one of the counterfeiting rings he was busting, and he tried to accept some sort of bribe, like, hey, $50,000, we can split it and you won't go to jail, which is total crap. Now, you might say, Vince, that's not as good. Is that your opinion? No, it isn't. The guy in question, his trial, told the same judge who coincidentally sent Abe to prison, says, you know what, I have to confess, I perjured myself in the Bolden trial. You know, he made up his testimony. So in other words, he admitted the DA suborned perjury to try to hurt Abraham Bolden's case. The district attorney was put before Judge Perry and said, is this true? In shades of Mark Furman in the OJ trial, what did the DA do? I want to exercise my Fifth Amendment privilege. Looked very bad, but in those pre-internet times, pre-Watergate times, when people just read the little fine print in black and white newspapers, and in the days of Jim Crow and anti-blacks and this, that, and the other, I would say 99.9% of people didn't notice or didn't care that this was going on. Now, oh, there would be protests. There'd be like nationwide protests. This guy is Abraham Bolden. This is ridiculous. The guy he was investigating for counterfeiting was the sole reason he got into trouble, and the guy admitted he lied, and the DA, rather than come clean, takes the Fifth Amendment. This is ridiculous. Okay, you might say to yourself, okay, that's a darn shame. What did Abraham Bolden get for something like that? What's that, like, eh, few weeks, few months for that? He served almost 6 years. Ridiculous. In federal penitentiary, too. They were trying to give him mind-altering drugs. Luckily, if you read his book, he spit it out, and surreptitiously, when no one was looking, shades of Jack Nicholson and One Flew the Cuckoo's Nest, he'd spit the medicine out and pretend he took it and whatnot. Ridiculous. They acted like he was a double murderer for something that was a white-collar crime at best, and again, something he didn't do. But the reason why they did that? To taint him. So now when he gets out, I'd be like, oh, Abraham Bolden, yeah, he's a convict. Ah, I don't believe anything he says. That's the reason why they did what they did to him. And I'm not the only one. Many prominent authors, researchers, many prominent attorneys, including obviously the late Mark Lane, adamantly believed what I espouse, that he was an innocent man, wrongly framed. He was a very good agent. And again, that's very telling. The few of the agents I spoke to, their first reaction was to speak pretty well of Abe. Then it clicked in their mind. Oh, wait a minute. That was Abraham Bolden. Never mind. You know, like, ooh, you know, that says a lot. And I also want to say one more thing about Abraham Bolden briefly. Conrad Cross, an agent I talk about in my book in the Abraham Bolden chapter, believes that Abraham Bolden was framed. So as a fellow agent believes he was framed, and Conrad Cross would know, he served with Abe in the Chicago field office. And during the Reagan assassination attempt, longtime secretary in the Chicago office, Jane Klepkowski, said something to the effect, you know what, watch these reports, watch what you do. I was in the Chicago office and some very shady things went on there. And I'll leave you with this and we'll talk about some other things, maybe go back to Jerry or whatever you want to do, Brent. But Maurice Martineau was especially in charge of the Chicago office and was not a friend of Abraham Bolden, but he begrudgingly thought he did a good job on counterfeiting, et cetera, et cetera. He told me he also believed there was a conspiracy agreeing with Abraham Bolden. And I asked him, I said, well, can you tell me more about it? He says, well, I'd rather not go on the record about it. I'd rather just not go into the details with you. And then about Abraham Bold, he got real angry. He says he was a blight on the agency. I don't want to discuss him, blah, blah, blah. But going to show you, Abraham Bolden was there and he saw things. It's very interesting that his boss was no love lost for Abe, also believes there was a conspiracy.
Also, Harvey Henderson, I wanted to give context to him as well. Harvey Henderson was from the old South and he was working on the Kennedy detail. And you can find this in Vince's book, Survivor's Guilt. And he was fired by Kennedy just prior to Kennedy going to Dallas. And the reason for that is Harvey Henderson had come out and said to Abraham Bolden in a drunken stupor one night, not Abraham, but Harvey Henderson, Bolden, you're an N-word. You're always going to be an N-word. So start acting like one. Can you imagine? And he also said that he would never protect the President of the United States. He wouldn't take the bullet for him because he was an N-lover. Can you imagine the audacity of somebody that his sole purpose in life is to protect the President of the United States coming out and declaring that?
Yes,
just outrageous.
Brent,
please.
Harvey came from Mississippi, and you know, deep, you know, a lot of racial divide there, especially in the early 60s. And, you know, Abraham Bolden goes on about his Mississippi background. Well, ironically, without naming him, Clint Hill, in another book on the Secret Service, says that, well, yeah, we had some agents from the Mississippi area who did not want to work with a black agent. Yeah, they definitely were racial and, you know, definitely, you know, had that problem. Well, the only agent from Mississippi that I'm aware of in all my research was Harvey Henderson. So he's actually corroborating Abraham Bolden. So very interesting on that point. Yeah.
All in the book, folks, and as well, a lot of this stuff is also in the documentary, A Coup in Camelot. Jerry, I want to go back to you, I'm going to come to Vince on this as well.
Oh, it's fine. Jerry's fascinating, by the way, on this segment he did. I really enjoyed that, yeah.
Oh, he's terrific. Fantastic show tonight, folks. Sherry Feaster has done crime scene investigation work, 21st century forensic science. She has found a frontal shot, but not from the grassy knoll on the north side, Jerry, but from the south side. What's your opinion of that?
It could be fairly accurate. Again, Sherry knows her stuff, and Sherry and I are friends, and I've known her for years because, you know, I've been part of the JFK Lancer conference. I was a forum administrator for them for many years, as Vince will tell you. But, yeah, it's very possible that back at the South Knoll, there's a wing there that kind of angles off. And you can't see it if you're standing on the triple underpass above Elm Street, which is where most of the railroad workers and the two police officers were standing, because there are concrete abutments that block your view. And then right behind that, it was the post office back. It was actually the Terminal Annex in 1963, the white building there in Dealey Plaza. And there was no fence. It was a public parking lot right behind that. So if they had any kind of silenced weapon or anything like that, you could take a shot from back there and no one would hear it if there was a silenced weapon. Even if someone did hear it, they may think it's an echo because it's also Dealey Plaza is a natural echo chamber as well. So it's very possible someone could have taken a shot there and gotten their car and just driven away because no one was paying attention to the South Knoll. Now, the documentary a few years ago by the History Channel or whatever it was, Inside the Magic Bullet, Beyond the Magic Bullet, and also the other one where they're talking about the shooters and shooting the headshot. They said you couldn't see across the crossbar and the windshield, but that extended limo with a raised back seat in the back going down at a downward angle, it's possible that you can see it from that area.
And I was going to mention that to you in just a few seconds, too, because one of the things I notice, folks, that you can't really notice on film or in pictures, there's two things when I was there in 2013 that came to me right away, which is the size of Dealey Plaza. It's tiny. The other thing was the steep grade of the street. I mean, it's a hill. It's not just a lumbering downwards type of street. It is a hill without question. You're walking downhill. So consequently, what that does, folks, is it puts the front of the car lower than the rear of the car. So you've got the president's head in a perfect position for a frontal shot and a head shot. It's like it's sticking out with a target on his head. Hit me, hit me, hit me. And I stood on the south side of the knoll where Sherry believes the fatal head shot came from. I want to reiterate this part. I'm getting a lot of comments on this. that Sherry never said there wasn't any shots from the Grassy Knoll. What she's saying very clearly, and I want to make this crystal clear, is that fatal headshot came from the south side of the knoll using 21st century crime scene techniques. And you can find her show on the www.nightfrightshow.com. And also, she explains everything in A Coup in Camelot right there. So, folks, I urge you all, this is a great documentary, without question. It has everybody in it and all their research as well. So I just wanted to get that crystal clear, that she's not saying there wasn't shots from anywhere else, the Grassy Knoll. She's saying the fatal headshot came from the south side. And it's a perfect way to escape because you've got access to the highway right there. And as Jerry just told everybody, you are blocked. You are concealed. There was nobody around on that side at all. So there you go. Vince, what do you think of her research?
Oh, I agree. I think it's excellent. It's very compelling. I remember her back in like the mid-90s. In fact, I was at JFK Lancer November 22nd, 1997 for a presentation. And she was also at the COPA conferences a couple years before that. And I was always very impressed with her blood spatter analysis. She covers everything from a forensic viewpoint, you know, taking the emotion out of it, just basically, you know, from, you know, CSI here, here's I am as a police officer. Okay, I got blood splatter. What's the blood splatter? Is the Bruder film telling me? Okay, well, the angle, okay, where would it come from? The good news, it comes from the front in her view, but the bad news, you put that in quotes, it's not from the traditional Grassy Knoll. Now, keep in mind, another thing too is not everything's black and white. There could have been a shot or shots from the classic northern Grassy Knoll we all know of, but it could have been the next shot and or one of the missed shots and or a headshot that missed. That's always a possibility, or grazed. But the bottom line she's talking about is the headshot that we know of that compels Kennedy backwards and to the left. That's the one that it came from the South Knoll. And a little over 2 weeks ago, I saw Jerry Dealey in Dealey Plaza, by the way. And I also took some amateur video and went up there on the overpass and went to the South Knoll. And I have to admit, seeing is believing. It's very compelling. It's very compelling on the Coup and Camelot DVD, her presentation, Jerry and everybody else. But boy, I tell you what, one thing that's really amazing from the South Knoll is the fact that you got to keep in mind, everybody's eyes were on the president to begin with, but no one's paying attention to that knoll. In a peripheral sense, people are paying attention to that knoll and that in the whole thing there because, yeah, you know, Abraham's Bruder's up there and, you know, your eyes, it's in the background, okay? But no one's paying attention to the South Knoll. And when you have a telescopic sight on a rifle, Kennedy on Elm Street, it might as well be like, you know, a couple feet away. And the way the underpass turns off there, it's not like people on the overpass proper could look over and say, oh, I see a gunman. No, he would have been hidden by the way the overpass just juts off. Now, on the other side, does the same thing too. But this was even more hidden, if that's possible, just because of the fact that I view it from like almost like a psychological standpoint, because, again, no one's looking over there. So, I mean, that's very compelling. And then when you factor in nebulous things about silencers and whatnot, well, then there you go. But the bottom line is to get to what Sherry was saying and add on to what Jerry says. Yeah, that South Knoll was very compelling. I think Sherry has done the best I've ever seen on the South Knoll. I've heard about people speculating in the past on it, but it never was anything more than a couple eyewitnesses. They kind of like try to like say maybe there's a possibility it came from there. But with her blood spatter, you know, and her dispassionate view of everything, it really is compelling. In fact, just speaking just in general about the Coup and Camelot DVD, I'm so proud to be part of this because just everybody, it's a forensic, it's such a, so many documentaries I've seen in the past, and I've seen countless, and I own many of them, are good, but what they usually suffer from are like a couple things. Though it's one theory or one avenue of the case milked for the whole program, they always have to include the inevitable Gerald Posners and Vince Bugliosi's of the world and all those type of people to rain on the parade and present the other view. I mean, we have the other view 24/7 with the official history, and they don't present a forensic view of the case. And that's what this does. I mean, you got Dick Russell and Jerry Dealey giving the excellent overview of everything, which is pertinent. You have to have that. And then, you know, me with the Secret Service, you have Doug Horn and Sherry Feaster and David Mandick. It's like the 1-2-3 punch of the forensics. And then Barry Ernest compliments what Jerry started out. It was excellent exposition on the you know, history of the book depository and whether shots could have come from the sixth floor, et cetera, et cetera. Everything he said complements tremendously Barry Ernst's research on The Girl on the Stairs, which is the name of his book. So, yeah.
Headshots, body shots. How many shots and where did they come from? How many shots hit Connolly? How many shots hit JFK, in your opinion, Vince? And then I'm going to ask Jerry the exact same question.
Okay. Yeah, in my opinion, first things first, I don't think that Oswald was a shooter. Now, this my opinion about this has changed over the years. Like a scientist, like any good, open-minded, honest person, you change, you go back and forth. Pat Spear and Deb Gallatin are on record agreeing with me on one thing. 10 years ago, I begrudgingly thought maybe Oswald was involved in all this, you know, kind of like what Kevin Costner and JFK said, no, maybe Oswald is what he is and maybe I'm just being stupid about it. You get jaded sometimes. But the bottom line is here in 2016, here's what I think. I think that Oswald's gun was used, but not Oswald. Oswald was down on the lunchroom. And he was the patsy for his gun being involved. Okay. Now a shot or shots came from the book depository. I think that Kennedy and Connolly received wounds from that location, and it was the wound in Kennedy's back. There never was any wound in the back of the neck. It stopped. In other words, yeah, when the people at the Bethesda autopsy, Paul O'Connor, Jim Jenkins, others said it never went through the pleural cavity. So it was either a dud or just the way it was. Just, you know, sometimes shots don't go through for whatever reason. And if old ammunition was used, whatnot. But bottom line sequence would be, yeah, JFK back shot, low on the shoulder, did not go through. Connolly gets shot in the back. Kennedy is then hit in the front. And I think that shot came from the classic Northern Knoll. Then there was at least one missed shot. That's the James Tagg miss. And now here's where it gets a little controversial. I think the front shot came from the front. I am torn between the excellent, tremendous Sherry Feaster, you know, compelling evidence that the shot came from the South Knoll. And there's a part of my brain that just can't get out of the fact of the traditional Knoll. The reason why I say that is that several railroad workers and whatnot saw smoke on the Knoll. They smelled gunpowder. So it could just be a happy medium, like we said earlier. It could be a shot or shots came from there, the next shot, a missed shot. And then you couple that with Sherry Feaster's South Knoll, and then we can all come together. Shots came from the front, but not the headshot. And, you know, the House Select Committee famously said a shot came from the Knoll but missed. So they were trying to have their cake and eat it, too, of Oswald acting alone. So I think it was Oswald's gun, not Oswald. Shots from the front, shots from the rear, and there you go, the headshot. That's why, you know, it's a little bit of controversy with it.
That's okay, Ben. That's good. We're up to 5 shots. Do you think just the one bullet hit Connolly in the back?
Yes, I do. I believe just the one shot hit him in the back, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so 5 shots, and the Warren Commission claims 3 folks.
Yeah.
Jerry, same question to you, my friend. Where did the shots originate from, and how many hit, and who did they hit?
I don't want to cop out, but I wish I knew. I really do.
Okay.
I'm going to talk a little bit about the missed shots. There was a number by the House Select Committee on Assassinations when they met. They were reported about 7 shots where bullets struck the pavement or sidewalk or grass or so on and so forth from 7 different witnesses. Now, some of these could be combined, but obviously if there's any more than one that struck the pavement anywhere, or maybe 2 if one of them kind of went down and hit the curb as well, there's got to be other shooters. Real quick on the headshot, classic grassy knoll like Vince was talking about. Again, people come up to me all the time. They say, well, if it's a headshot here and it hit him in the right front, which is the closest point to the grassy knoll, it would have hit the left side of the brain. Well, maybe a shot from the classic grassy knoll almost missed. In other words, it barely caught the back of the head and does not necessarily have to be the closest point, the, you know, right temple area to the grassy knoll. I mean, if someone came close to missing, then there could be 2 shots that hit the head, but just one of them hit in the back right, and the other one came from the left front, like Sherry is talking about.
I agree with Jerry. That's a good point. Very good.
And on Connolly, Jerry?
On Connolly, I do think it was only 1 shot. It may have even been the stretcher bullet, even though I really find that doubtful, because more was supposedly in Connolly's body than what was missing from that bullet. That bullet was probably planted. You got to remember there was an epileptic seizure there in Dealey Plaza before the president came in, and that person was taken to Parkland Hospital and was sitting on a stretcher by Aubrey Reich. And he was sitting there, and after the president showed up, he disappeared. Well, there was a stretcher in the hallway, and a bullet is found later on. So some people think Jack Ruby may have planted one. Some of them think that this epileptic seizure, which was not real, planted one. Other people may just say the FBI substituted the bullet after the fact to kind of prove it and tie it to Oswald's gun, because there's a chain of evidence problem on every piece of evidence in this case.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like nothing else before. And it's just unbelievable to think that the president of the United States could be shot, and such a shoddy job of evidence. And I was going to talk to you a little bit about the Zapruder film. Jerry, has the ground changed much over the years since 1963?
Well, yes and no. I mean, of course, the landscape has changed, and, you know, some of the grass, and they've added dirt or taken it away and everything else. Zapruder perch itself has probably settled a little bit over the years, so I don't think it's changed very much. But Dealey Plaza, for the most part, they try to keep it the way it was. Again, you never know.
Damn, there's the music. Don't you hate when that happens? Just when you're in the middle of something. Okay, guys, I got to close out. So I want to thank you both so much for coming on the show. Jerry Dealey's been our guest tonight. Vince Palamara, you'll be able to find the show at the www.nightfrightshow.com website, along with a link to A Coup in Camelot. I am Brent Holland from Night Fright. See you all next time. Thanks, guys.
Thanks a lot.
JFK Assassination, the definitive book by Brent Holland. From inside the Oval Office to Dealey Plaza, first-person witness accounts. Order yours right now, nightfrightshow.com.